Okay, so we're ready for our next panel on law enforcement and criminal justice. Our moderator is Dr. Todd Clear, and he's going to be introducing himself and the panel. Also, I just want to say, regarding lobbying, no one needs to panic. Lobbying is only if you're saying something like, go and vote for or against local law XYZ in this municipality, which nobody's doing. So you're all right. Okay.
Good afternoon. So I'd like to express my appreciation to be asked to come down and introduce this panel. The panel's on law enforcement and criminal justice in the theme of the city as health policy. And I can tell you there could be no more important topic to think about from the point of view of a person who works every day in Newark, New Jersey. I am the former provost at Rutgers University in Newark, and also I was the dean of the School of Criminal Justice for a while as well. And in both of those roles, we did a lot of work on public safety related issues. Newark just recently elected a mayor who has made public safety a central part of his agenda and has redefined it as a public health issue. We are engaging questions like trauma, questions like access, questions like family health, and it has been a refreshing new era for the city of Newark. In returning to the faculty, I have been busier than ever working in close relationship to the city's leadership on public safety agenda items, and I'd be happy to talk more about that later. I don't know if anyone here had the same kind of reaction I had when I saw Walter Scott killed by a police officer in Charleston, South Carolina on video. So I've been in the field of criminal justice since the early 1970s. I've been working on my main area is prison reform and prison policy, but I've been working on community-oriented justice issues, written a handful of books, half a dozen books that had somehow community or justice in the title. And I thought I understood what happened when police officers encountered citizens in dangerous situations. And I couldn't believe what I saw. And part of what I couldn't believe was the realization, kind of an embarrassing thing for a person in my position to admit, but the realization that if this thing had not been caught on camera, it would have been a police officer protecting himself from a citizen who had endangered his life. And the city police would have said this, the newspapers would have said this, and the person who was executed, laying on the ground, would have been vilified as a person who tried to kill police officers. If you go into the School of Criminal Justice today, there is up in Newark in our school, and if you don't know about the School of Criminal Justice, we are held to be among the top three or four graduate programs in criminology and criminal justice in the country. If you go into the school today, what's called the Criminal Justice Art Collection, and on the walls there is art now about police killings of young black men. And just a series of paintings. And it cannot help but take your breath away. And the room that it's around, which is the main meeting room of the School of Criminal Justice, is the room that we use to host meetings when we host the state police, the police department of the city of Newark, the Safer Newark Council, the Attorney General's office. Whenever anybody comes to the School of Criminal Justice to have a meeting with us, they're in that room. And we have shown them what the feelings are in the world. It's funny, we don't really count how many American citizens are killed by police officers every year. And that's the most dramatic gone wrong interaction between law enforcement and citizens. But it's quite rare. Most police officers go their entire careers without ever drawing their guns from their holsters, without ever shooting a bullet. By far most. So the fact that 400 people are killed every year, roughly speaking, as best we can count them, by police officers, is an indication of the size of rare events. But what really, the dean of the school, Colonel Justice Rod Brunson, is known for his groundbreaking work on young black men in the police. He did street ethnographies of young black men in the police, and the title of his most famous articles is "Them Police Don't Like Me." And there is something today afoot about legitimate criminal justice in the United States that has to be worked through to its stage of healing. We are in the early days, and I don't think you can say with confidence that we will get to a better place. But it is no longer possible to talk about justice or crime or urban unrest or public safety without engaging the problem of the way law enforcement has historically policed impoverished communities, particularly communities of color. I'm quite actually excited about the fact that this conversation is going on, because at the same time, we're also talking about mass incarceration, which is an area that is in my specialty, where I spend most of my time. It came from a meeting yesterday in Washington, and what is happening is the freedom that elected officials have today to talk about this as an issue is unimaginable 5 years ago, literally unimaginable five years ago. In July, I will go to a meeting hosted by the Koch brothers in Washington, D.C., to talk about how can we take on the problem of mass incarceration. Now, I'm no great fan of the Koch brothers, but I'm enormously impressed by the time that we find ourselves in right now, where we are being forced by events around us, by the things we have done from policy, by the things we have done from practice, by the things we have allowed to happen around us. We are forced to confront the way in which the criminal justice system has been a part of the degrading of urban life in impoverished communities in urban settings in America. I could actually talk for two more hours about this, but we have a panel, and they're prepared to be more specific and more informed than I am on these issues. Their bios are here. I'm not going to have to tell them more about you except to introduce them. Jonathan Smith is the Associate Dean of the University of District of Columbia School of Law. Nahal Zamani is the Advocacy Program Manager at the Center for Constitutional Rights. And Craig Futterman is the Clinical Professor of Law at the University of Chicago Law School. And they will take my hopefully incendiary remarks and move them down the road even more so. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I actually wasn't going to talk about body cams, but I want to say one thing since you have started down that path. One of the things about this last couple of years that has been both very disturbing but remarkable is how much video there is. You can't, every week there's another horrible incident that's been captured on video. And what it has done, I think, is two things. One, which is obvious that everybody's talking about, is that now everybody can see what happens when police encounter African-American men and African-American women. And this narrative that these were one-off encounters or that these were people who were assaulting the police or whatever has been dispelled, and that is undeniable at this point that narrative is false. But the other thing that it has done that I don't think we've paid anything close to enough attention to is the fact that it is revealed that we have not believed for decades black testimony on these issues. And that I think that's actually in some ways a more important question in terms of solving the problem going forward. Why is it that when people of color talk about their encounters with police, we just simply didn't believe them? We only believe them when we see them with our own eyes. And I'm worried that we still only believe it when we see it with our own eyes. And so I think Craig's probably gonna spend more time on this. And that wasn't what I came to talk about, but you inspired me, because this has been something that's been so deeply on my mind for the last couple of years, and I don't know what to do with it and can't shake this problem, but it really seems to me that it reveals quite a lot about us. And to me, it is one of those enormous hills that we've yet to start to climb, that we have to climb if we're really going to create equity and fairness in the way law enforcement works. And so in any event, So I'm actually here to talk about the Ferguson Report. I had the tremendous honor to work for the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice. I was chief of the Special Litigation Section when the Ferguson Report was, when the investigation took place and when it was written. And I worked with a, and all the credit goes to a really remarkable team of lawyers and investigators who spent every waking hour for about 6 months investigating the Ferguson Police Department and the Ferguson Municipal Court and issuing this report. I am not going to be able to tell you everything that's in the report. I'm going to try to give you some sense of what the highlights of the report were and some conclusions that we reached. And if you have not had a chance to read it, I encourage you, I really, and this is not just because I was involved in the writing of it, but I really encourage people to read it because we made a real effort when we did the work on the report, and the team really made a huge effort to try to make it a report that spoke to the entire community. This was not a government-to-government document. This wasn't something coming out of the Civil Rights Division to the city of Ferguson, but this was written so that there would be a baseline, a set of facts that everybody could take as the foundation for bringing about reform and to build a catharsis. And so we tried to make it readable. We tried to include the voices of people who are most likely to have been injured in that report and to reflect all communities. We also wrote the report because Ferguson, and I'm going to talk a little about this, Ferguson, while it manifests itself in a fairly unique set of characteristics, the things that happen in Ferguson are happening in every jurisdiction across this country. Ferguson is not unique. And so we need to read it because we need to understand it. And we need to know the ways in which it's profoundly affecting every courthouse and every police department in this nation. Now, we were involved in the civil investigation. We didn't investigate the death of Michael Brown. We were tasked by the Attorney General to investigate what was the relationship between the police and the community leading up to the shooting of Michael Brown and the rebellion of the community that resulted since. And as it turns out, actually, police shootings in Ferguson are quite rare, and there hadn't been one for 10 years prior to Michael Brown's death. But the community clearly was in a place where there was something going on, and there was a lot of indicia of a pattern or practice of violation of the Constitution by the police department. And so we were sent in to try to figure out what was going on with this police department. Was there a constitutional problem? Was this a unique experience? This is every investigation we undertook. We went in with not having reached a conclusion, but an open question, and what was really happening in the city of Ferguson. And we came away, and I'm going to give you the headline now and then try to walk you through a little bit of how we got there. We came away with two conclusions. The first was that it was a criminal justice system that had been distorted from one that was designed to provide public safety, or had it really, however you may define public safety, had public safety at its core, to one that had at its core the raising of revenue for the city. It was a public, it had been completely distorted away from any concern about any community's legitimate concerns about public safety. Power, communities in power, communities not in power, neighborhoods, it had been really moved away from that function to one where the city was used to raise revenue to the city. And the second is that it was deeply influenced by questions of race, and that the use of law enforcement was, and those tactics to raise funds from certain communities, was exclusively from the African American community. So the starting point, I think, earlier we, several people have talked about the importance of history. And for me, when we started to think about Ferguson, I started to try to understand what was going on. How did we get to this place in the city of Ferguson? And it's important, I think, to go back to the backdrop of the racial segregation of St. Louis and St. Louis County. St. Louis, oddly enough, I've done a lot of work throughout the South and in other places. St. Louis was one of the strangest places because the old guard civil rights movement, almost like it leaped over. It was, in many ways, the lions of the movement were not there. There's no generation of people to go to who had done that work, even though there had been these great important civil rights moments in Ferguson. But Ferguson was a highly segregated community. It's about 15 miles north west of St. Louis City. Until the 1960s, by law, African Americans could not be on the streets of Ferguson after dark, and they could only be within the city limits of Ferguson if you were employed by a white family. It was by law a sundown town. They literally closed the streets between the neighboring African American community with barriers every night when the sun went down and took them up at sunrise. Charlie versus Kramer, the restrictive covenant case Raisin and the Sun, everybody's seen Raisin and the Sun, fabulous play about African-American family moving into a white neighborhood, took place about 9 miles from where Michael Brown died. The house that was the subject of the litigation with the Supreme Court that struck down restrictive covenants happened about 9 miles from where Michael Brown died. Because of a whole complicated history that I can't get into now that has a lot to do with school desegregation and the school desegregation decree in St. Louis City and the creation of a unified school district of the county, you saw this dramatic change in demographics that took place from the 1960s up until today. So in 1960, you had no one who lived in Ferguson who was African American, unless you lived in the home of a white family. By 1990, that had become 25% of the community had been African American. And when Michael Brown was shot, it was 67% of the community was African American. But that doesn't mean it was an integrated community. It was profoundly segregated. The white community lived in traditional neighborhoods with single family homes. The African American community lived in low-rise townhouses that were in a certain segment of the town and that had, as largely as a result of pressure from the community, the developers of those townhouses had gated them off and had restricted access to those communities. When I first met with the chief of police and we were talking about this, he started to explain these horrible slums that these townhouses were, and then I went to see them and really quite nice communities, and so it just shows you how those impressions come in. The segregation is not only limited to housing. The school districts, which are county school districts, are drawn so that the African American community is in a primarily African American school district, and the white community is primarily in a white school district. And I don't mean just majority. I mean 99% African American for African American students and 99% white for the white students. So that's the backdrop in which you start to see what's going on. In Ferguson is one of 90 communities in the St. Louis County. About 50 of the communities have their own police department and have their own court. Some of those communities are as small as 500 people and have a police department and a municipal court. Under Missouri law, your court can mirror the state code and you can create your own code up to a certain level of crime, and that if you're charged in the municipal code, you go to the municipal court, the fines go to the municipality, not to the state. If you're charged in the state under the state code, you go to the state court and the fines go to the state system. And one of the things that was lucky for us was that once we began our investigation, we found out that the court was actually part of the police department. The chief of the court reported to the chief of police because the Civil Rights Division, we only had jurisdiction to investigate law enforcement. We typically don't have the authority to investigate courts. This is the only time you'll ever see the Civil Rights Division having investigated a court outside the juvenile context. We had authority to investigate juvenile courts outside the juvenile context. And that was because it was part of the police department. We were only able to actually do this investigation because of an organizational quirk in St. Louis. But what happened was the city, after the Great Recession, saw a loss of income, and it made a conscious decision that it was going to use its police and its courts to raise revenues. In 2010, the court raised about $1.4 million in fines. That went up by 2.6 million. In 2015, they projected in their budget they would raise $3.1 million. And it was stunning, the actual email record you have of this process, where you had the city manager, the finance director, the chief of police, the clerk of the court, and the mayor emailing back and forth about how much money they could raise, with the finance director writing to the mayor saying, can the chief get me 7.5% more next month? The chief writing back, I think I can get 10% if I just change the way we organize the police and how we assign them and what we tell them to do. And so you had this, it was clear, you could see in the email traffic this transformation. We didn't find a single email that says, there's a public safety problem because of this, or can you in this neighborhood, there's been a lot of car break-ins or whatever. All you saw in the discussion of the police was in the email exchanges was how much money could they make, how many tickets could they write, How could they trap people in the system, and how could they keep them there? So the court changed its practices, actually, to raise revenue. It became something of a trap. Once you got stuck, you could never get out. There's one of the stories that we encountered, and this is by no far unique, but one of the women, and I will never forget, it just is seared in my brain. She, you know, you pay in a meter. If you don't pay enough in the meter, they write you a ticket. Well, in Ferguson, that's a $102 ticket. So you don't put enough quarters in the meter, you get a $102 ticket. Now, that may be for merchants, it may be important that people pay in meters so that you get turnover of traffic and what have you. But, you know, she did this twice. She had $204 worth of tickets that she owed. And because she couldn't pay them, she got on a payment plan. And when she got on a payment plan, they added fees. And when she didn't make the payment plan, they added more fees. It ballooned to $1,500 she couldn't pay. She spent 6 days in jail, became homeless, and lost her job, and her kids went into social services because she didn't put enough quarters into a parking meter. Now, that's not a public safety-driven result. If what you're trying to do is accomplish public safety, making people homeless, putting them into jail, causing them to lose their jobs, is not the job. And we met thousands of people who had similar stories, not exactly that story, but stories where their lives were ruined by getting caught up in the system. The court met, and I'm sorry I'm talking really fast because I know I'm like probably over time now, but the court met two or three times a month. There would be 500 people in line. There was no waiting room. People snaked out into the parking lot in the rain and the heat and in the snow in order to pay. You didn't stay. They would put a warrant for your arrest. It would go up. And this was happening not just in Ferguson, but it was happening all over St. Louis County. So if you had a ticket in Ferguson and you had a ticket in Florida, three or four, you would end up what they called on the Muni shuffle. You failed to pay here, you failed to pay there, you'd go spend time in the Ferguson jail, and then when you did your enough time to pay off your debt there, they'd move you to another jurisdiction. It was a common phenomenon that just drove people underground. There were never lawyers. The court judge says, well, I don't have to appoint lawyers because I never send anybody to jail. He says, but there's all these people that go to jail. He says, well, no, I never send them to jail for the crime they committed. I sent them to jail for failing to pay. I don't have to give them lawyers for that. And so that's how you ended up having this just shocking system. And the level of callousness, we literally, my lawyers and my team, most people go in, they can't pay the fines because they're so high, they get on a payment plan, which is something of a trap, candidly, because there's all these ways that you might screw up. You have to go in person when the window's open to pay. It's only a few times a month. Literally, it's supposed to stay open from 2 to 5 or something every Wednesday. At 4:30, lawyers from the investigative team are standing there. They're being observed. They're standing there, and somebody comes running in to pay her fine at 4:30, and the clerk closes the window in her face, and a warrant is issued for her arrest. And so this is a system to get you trapped in and keep you there and suck you dry. The police also changed their practices. They changed the hours in which they patrolled. They prioritized things like equipment violations because it allowed you to pull a car over and then you could write multiple tickets on the car. Younger officers would compete to how many tickets they could write on a single stop. They were under pressure to be productive. They told them the more tickets you write, the more likely you're going to get a pay raise. And there was a whole series of ways in which they would issue warrants for people's arrests. Now, one thing to just kind of place this in context, there's 21,000 people in the city of Ferguson. In 2009, they wrote 24,000 traffic tickets and 20,000 non-traffic tickets. That's a lot. By 2014, under pressure to raise revenue, that rose to 53,000 traffic tickets and 50,000 non-traffic tickets. Now, the non-traffic tickets are things like you didn't cut your lawn. You have a car that doesn't start in your driveway, they call it a derelict car. Manner of walking in roadway, which is what Michael Brown was theoretically doing at the time that he was killed. It's their form of jaywalking. I just love the expression manner of walking in roadway. I sort of get it. It's like a Groucho Marx joke. We don't know what they did because we know that they had 11,000 vehicle stops in that two-year period, but they don't track pedestrian stops. And so we don't know, but every young man we talked to of color told us that he had been stopped, and his encounter with the police always started with, hey, you, get the F over here. And, you know, over and over and over again, we would hear that that was the, and then frequently those would result in tickets being written or warrants being issued. So this is bad. It's bad if it's done against everybody and there's not discrimination, but it's particularly bad the way it was applied in Ferguson because of its distinct impact on the African-American community. 67% of the population is African-American, and what we heard criticism of our report, although the statistics back it up, is that, well, you know, different racial groups offend at different rates. The courts have validated that. I mean, it's sort of an absurd notion, but the courts have validated that notion. So you have to prove that it really is motivated by race. 85% of the stops were African-American, 90% of the citations, 93% of the arrests. That doesn't get us over the hurdle of showing it was based on discrimination from the case law. It may, for you scientists, get over the hurdle, but judges don't tend to watch the science so carefully. So we had to show that there were other ways to show that this was motivated by race. So we looked at the kinds of things that you relied on police officer discretion. So African Americans were twice as likely to be searched when they were stopped, but 26% likely to have contraband. So searches against whites were 26% more likely to be productive than searches against African Americans. African Americans got more multiple tickets. Over 73 African Americans over a four-year period got four more tickets. Only two whites got four or more tickets. Things that were officers could make decisions, 93% of the manner of walking in roadway, 84% of failure to comply. And failure to comply was often a crime that was issued when somebody didn't quickly enough give you their identification. Officer would come up to you and say, give me your driver's license. You say, what do you want it for? He'd issue a ticket for failure to comply. 40%, so this was great. If they used a speeding gun, there was still a disparity between white and black, partially probably because of which cars they targeted. But if they did it through observation, following a car, that disparity grew by 48%. So the observational disparities when the officer was observing speeding rather than using a radar showed the bias. So we're able to triangulate around, oh God, all right, use of force. So the only other thing, just really quickly, because I am out of time, is that it wasn't just limited to the impact on the African American community. It wasn't just limited to the writing of tickets and the raising of revenue, but it also went to other basic police functions. We saw that there was a dramatic mismatch in terms of disparities in the use of force, and particularly things where, like the use of canines. Now, it's very unusual for a department that small to have a canine unit to begin with, and think about what canines in the whole civil rights movement, the role that dogs have played. You can't think of, you know, you go back thinking about Birmingham, right? I mean, but they used of all the canine bites that we found, every one of them was an African American, including the use of a canine to get a kid who was truant from school out of a closet, and who was an African American kid. So we saw this incredible disparity across everything that we looked at. The only other thing I want to say is that, you know, you see these kinds of things manifest themselves everywhere. You've got private probation and parole, the way cash bail system worked, charging people for their public defenders, the roots of private prisons, the use of private parole services where people get charged for all kinds of things that are not even related to the crime that they're accused of having committed. And so I just want to end with that, is to remind folks that what goes on in Ferguson, while it has these, you know, really horrible characteristics, and in some ways the way things came together were unique to Ferguson, or at least that upper tier of St. Louis County, if you look everywhere in the country, and you go into any urban or rural courthouse, any urban or rural police department, you're going to find things that are happening that share some of the characteristics of what we saw in Ferguson. So I'm sorry if I talked really fast.
So I'm always glad to come back to Rutgers. It's my alma mater. I graduated some time ago. I'm also really glad to be here because this particular location where this hotel was built is a very important space in New Brunswick in terms of how it's been developed for certain communities, and how dramatically the city has grown, and how many problems that has been, how the development has been really problematic. I used to come here when I was a high schooler. I grew up in a nearby town, and we used to give away food right around here, right where this hotel sits, to folks that were homeless and poor. And the incredible difference decades later now about how this city looks and what services are accessible to people is really striking to me, and I think really timely for this type of conversation. So, my name is Nahal. I work with the Center for Constitutional Rights. We're a human rights organization and civil rights organization. We're based in Manhattan. We work all across the world. I run our advocacy campaigns looking at compelling human rights issues in the United States. I'm really drawn by our practice. We were founded sending lawyers down to support social rights activists during civil rights struggles about 50 years ago. And since then, we've been trying to be on the corner of and the front line of social justice struggles, filing really timely legal challenges and work that I do, which is building up campaigns and networks that change and build power. We've been involved with issues like sending down the first attorneys to Guantanamo Bay to suing the Vatican for promoting a culture of rape. And I'll talk a little bit about our work with NYPD, which is very, very current and contemporary. I'm going to focus on New York City because I think it's a really relevant model for policing issues across the U.S. And worldwide, and also because the police department is so big and so influential on the way that it's practiced policing and exported its policing practices, I think have a lot of ramifications around the country in particular. And I find these things pretty timely in terms of where we are. So, we work on ending discriminatory and abusive policing. And we're drawn to this issue, unfortunately, because it's an epidemic that's being realized, but it has been going on for many, many years. We know about what the NYPD does because of the way that it records its activity and has been mandated to report on that publicly. And that was predominantly through the issue of stop and frisk. Which became a huge issue over the last couple of years, but was something that at least we've been working on for about 15 years. And no one was talking about it in the public discourse, but for many communities of color, they were bearing the brunt of this abusive and discriminatory practice for decades and decades. And New York is the perfect, you know, embodiment of how abusive, zero tolerance, broken windows policing was practiced. And on the backs of communities of color and low-income communities, which in New York dovetails. The issue had been going on for many years, and a lot of different communities have been facing the brunt of practices by the NYPD because they were targeted on the basis of who they were. So stop and frisk was very visible, again, for a number of reasons that I'll go into. But also, Muslims are being surveilled by the NYPD, including student groups here on New Brunswick that we're representing. You know, and they've been surveilled on the basis of their religion or their ethnicity. Folks who are low income or homeless are targeted on the basis of their perceived or actual housing status. Folks that have are perceived not to be citizens are targeted as a result. For many decades, people have been organizing in New York against issues of police brutality. We were home to a lot of heinous and gross and horrific incidents. In the 90s, many communities were organizing consistently and really holding it down and drawing attention to the abusive practices by the NYPD. A number of them, including the Malcolm X grassroots movement, came to my organization and said, we need you to sue the NYPD while we hold it down on the street. So we sued the unit that had killed Amadou Diallo in the late 90s. And as you know, litigation takes forever. So while that was happening, folks were organizing. And building. A few years later, we settled with them. As a result of that settlement, we were able to get consistent information, which we then made public, about stop and frisk, which was the NYPD's own use of this practice and who it was being practiced on. We also won a couple of other things, but we ultimately headed back in court a number of years later because the issue was not solved. Unfortunately, the unit that we had sued, even though it was disbanded in the course of that lawsuit and as a ramification, had been practicing stop and frisk, the entire department was scaling up its issue and its use of this practice. And then September 11th happened, and that was a big, big deterrent in organizing for a lot of the movements that had been so vibrant and had been so well organized. And it really limited their capacity and the political space for them to make the public discourse necessary around these types of policing practices. So as we headed into the early 2000s and later 2000s, there was really a need for all of us that have been doing different areas of work to come together. And this is kind of the birth of one of the most impactful campaigns, I think, that I've been a part of, called Communities United for Police Reform. And what it did is it really centered the impact of policing practices, drawing linkages to different types of policing that was made on the basis of targeting people on the basis of their identities and not because of their actual criminal activities. We needed to build that movement and launch legal challenges and advocacy campaigns from this vision of the expertise of people that are most affected by these types of practices. And we also needed, we knew, to secure enough political will that we could go above and beyond critiques of us and really kind of show that a broad swath of New Yorkers were against abuses that were happening in their name. So Communities United for Police Reform launched in 2011, 2012. It has been one of the most impactful multi-pronged campaigns that I've been a part of, bringing together researchers, advocates, activists, community-based ones, academics and researchers, and folks that know kind of how to affect policy together to think about what we would do to change policing in New York. Some of the wins that it's had so far, first of all, it made stop and frisk a mayoral issue, so much so that the mayor that came in and is now currently in office put his own son in a commercial. His son is biracial, and talked about the abusive practice of stop and frisk, which at that point had jumped up and ran dramatically in its documented use. Nearly 700,000 stops per year in its peak. And the mayor made a promise that if elected, the mayor-elect, you know, that I would stop this reeling in of abusive policing practices in my name. The campaign also launched and was successful in ushering the signing into law of two pieces of legislation. One that really made a comprehensive ban on profiling, banning the police from engaging in law enforcement activities on the basis of people's identities. So looking at that specific targeting of communities and all the different ways that they were targeted, and introducing a new inspector general of the NYPD. At the time, all major New York City agencies, government agencies, had some kind of independent watchdog that did a bird's eye view of their practices. But the NYPD, at the time, answered to no one. So we were able to successfully pass into law over at the time, the mayor's objections and the police commissioner's objections. They were very loud and very dramatic, and pass that into law and ultimately fill that office. We were also able to center a lot of the community-based activists that have been doing Know Your Rights trainings and Cop Watch for many, many years. A number of our Cop Watchers in New York are the folks that have trained and been trained by others around the country. And so we really kind of streamlined and then expanded dramatically that practice. So we had folks working on policy, we had folks like us working on litigation, we had folks documenting police abuse on the street. And all of this was to increase the capacity of people that were most affected by these types of policing practices to hold the police accountable, to decrease encounters on the street that were ultimately playing out and having real serious ramifications on people's lives, and to win. To make this such an impactful issue that people had no decision but to be involved in this fight. That campaign, I think, has been quite remarkable because of it really centered and made as spokespeople the people that were most impacted. And at the same time, it also increased the capacity of our community-based partners. My organization, Center for Constitutional Rights, is a legal and advocacy organization. We're not comprised of members, but a lot of our partners have been doing this for many, many years with a lot less resources than I have. So in order for us to be even told when to file lawsuits, our partners have to be at the same playing field as us. So it's absolutely important that our partners have the same capacity, sustained financial, and also resource-wise to be able to continue the work. And then I'll talk a little bit about the two of the things that we did in light of this broader campaign. We filed a second lawsuit, so we went back to court as if we weren't, you know, dealing with a lot of drama with NYPD. We went back, we sued the entire police department in 2008. We accused them of, and we were ultimately successful in convincing a federal judge to find them liable for engaging in unconstitutional stops and frisks and racial profiling. That was a really dramatic, long battle that played out its way in the press. We had a great statement of interest from your former agency in our case. This was one of the most important court cases ever, not because of the sheer magnitude of what it was challenging, but because of the public's interest and investment in this case. Literally every day after years of litigation, we headed to trial. For 9 weeks, affected New Yorkers filled the courtroom because they were so invested in the federal court system recognizing what had been happening to their communities for many years. In 2013, a judge found the NYPD and the city of New York liable and ordered them to engage in a reform process. And that's where we are right now. What the judge did, which I think was brilliant, and I think builds on a little bit of this practice that I think even the DOJ is starting to put in their reports. It's my favorite part from the report, by the way. Not only how crazy stuff was going on in Ferguson, but this idea that affected communities have to be developing the policies that affect them, which means policing practices as well. In our case, a judge said, there are 752 things that are recognized in the NYPD's practice of stop and frisk, which need to be changed. I'm gonna name about 18 of them that need to be changed immediately. And the rest, I want affected New Yorkers to be recognized as official stakeholders in this process and to develop hand in hand with the NYPD the type of policing practices that need to be happening. That's where we are right now in New York. We have in the backspread of the Communities United for Police Forum a number of reforms that are in the process of being actualized. A really great kind of army of New Yorkers that are empowered, that know their rights, that are documenting police abuse, and are also standing in and really articulating changes to policing practices so that they can be less abusive and they can be more centered on upholding their dignity. And within the legal process, we're able to actually formally have places for the meaningful input of affected New Yorkers to come in with us and help develop policies and practices together. And lastly, I was really excited about the shout out to engaging with international human rights mechanisms. We're also a human rights organization, and so we've been for years now using these periodic reviews by independent human rights experts to talk about what's happening in New York and Ferguson and other places. And I have to say, we're in a very rare moment. This is the second or third time of finally going through this full review process where these independent human rights experts consistently are saying police brutality is an issue, what's happening in Ferguson was a terrible issue, what's happening in New Orleans and other places is terrible, this is infringing not only on your constitutionally protected rights, on the dignity of Americans and of folks living in the US, but also these are violating international human rights standards that the government is obligated to uphold. So we have been able to not only shift the dialogue in New York, I would say in the US, but also internationally to use a lot of these venues and mechanisms to talk about what is a recognized epidemic here. I would never have said that this stuff hasn't been happening, and it has been happening for many, many years. And that's been formally recognized in a number of those treaty review processes. So these are some quick lessons if you ever want to launch a campaign for what we think works. One is, you know, as I said, we are a legal and advocacy organization. Our leadership and the way that we engage has to come from our partners. And our partners are generally the most affected communities that are realizing that have felt that their rights are being violated and they're articulating the type of change that they want to see. Of course, we dreamt when we came up with our goals, but we've been achieving them, especially in the last 5 to 6 years, dramatically so. And we're in the process of figuring out how to implement and monitor them. I think, you know, the latter points are really about for you guys, if you're in organizing spheres, about thinking about what your role is and how you build power and how you affect change. And also, you know, even when you win court cases or you win and you implement and get signed into law, legislation, implementation and monitoring are some of the most key things to do. And that's actually a place that we can affect more power. So it's not about saying this is what the police should be doing. It's more about watching them and making sure that for government agencies and social agencies such as them that wield so much power that they really need to be held accountable in every way.
Good afternoon. Right. My students and I have spent a good part of the last 4 years or more talking and really more importantly listening to black high school students about their experiences with the police. It's part of what we call the Youth Police Project in Chicago. It's a collaboration between Mandel Legal Aid Clinic of the law school and something called the Invisible Institute. Consistent with really Nahal's work, which he was describing with Communities United, our project rests on this primary premise. And that's just simply that people, young people particularly, most affected by urban police practices, possess critical knowledge, perspective, that's all too often absent from academic conversations like these. Simply put, kids closest to the ground know stuff that most of us just don't know. And so after numerous conversations that we had south and west sides of Chicago, we immersed ourselves for the last 2 years in a high school called High Park Academy, which is just about 5 blocks south of where I teach at the University of Chicago. And while we've heard terrible stories of abuse, our focus isn't on that. It hasn't been on the Michael Brown type incidents. We focus on the everyday stuff. Some of what Nahal was talking about and what folks have been organizing about, on the countless interactions that occur between, that take place really on a daily basis between black kids and police across this country. Methodology is simple. We ask black high school students to describe their experiences with police, and we listen. And before I talk more, if I can figure this out, maybe Professor Kwati will help me figure this out. I think it's important that you hear from the kids we speak.
Your full name?
Jamari Triggs, senior.
Hassanti Vernon.
Erica Johnson.
Montreux.
Richard Porter.
James Adams.
Christopher Moore.
Anaya Collins.
I mean, I just be walking with my friends or something. Well, you know, I could be walking by myself and then, you know, they'll pull up, you know, get on the car, you know, or get on the wall, you know, spread your legs, put your hands up, you know, put your hands on the gate, don't move, you know, searching my pockets, you know.
How often does that happen?
Pretty much every time I go outside.
No, last year, around this time, it would be a lot of random stops, just random stops.
Yeah, that's an everyday thing. They ride around there all the time.
They just stop and hope and guess that you was doing something. Basically, that's the way I feel. They just be like, people on the street, run your pockets. Let me see what you got up in your pocket.
I mean, like, if that's what they're looking for, that's a bad tactic. Because they're just going to make us feel more bitter about them and not want to cooperate.
It just make you feel down, like you ain't nobody. It ain't make you feel like that because they think they the police and they got all the power.
They're over you and you're under them. Therefore, you don't matter. Their word will prevail over yours.
It made me feel small because, like, I was stopped for no reason. I was just minding my business.
Say more about that. It
made me feel like a less than a, you know, I'm almost a man, but it made me feel less than a man, you know, them stopping me and, you know, somebody going into my pockets, you know.
Mm-hmm. It's like restricting. You can't do stuff that regular people would because it's like you being harassed.
Yeah, they make you feel less of a person, like I said.
They have all the power and they can do what they want and they can get away with it.
Right, it felt like I was a nobody, you know.
I mean, every situation is upsetting with the police, you know, and they ain't never no good encounters that you have with the police.
At first, I was like, the police are good and stuff like that, and then now I'm sort of like, they're capable of anything. I don't know what could happen if I were to be stopped again.
You know, it's basically like you got good cops and bad cops out there, you know. And I think it's a small number of good cops.
Yeah.
It's a big number of bad cops. That's how I look at it.
So if I was ever to get into something, I wouldn't call, the police would be the last person I call. I call family before police.
Well, given my past experience, I wouldn't call the police.
I wouldn't call for nothing.
Man, my son get older, and I hope that they change, I guess, the training that the police have, because by the time he get older, I'm guessing or I'm hoping that the police be done changed. Some of their attitudes or the training that they receive needs to change.
Let me just highlight for the lessons that we learned from the kids before, at least talking briefly about policy implications. First thing that jumped out to us was that there was just a completely different constitution that governs kids in black neighborhoods than what we teach in our law school classrooms. In contrast to most of my law students, the high school kids see police as a ubiquitous presence in their neighborhoods. They each live with the ever-present possibility of being stopped, searched, and treated with suspicion of being a criminal. Encounters in which kids feel that the police have all the power. High schoolers would describe to me as routine hostile encounters in which officers command kids to put their hands against the wall, spread their legs to be searched. And everything about these encounters, from the officer's swagger, their gait as they approach, to their tone of voice, seem calculated to convey messages of authority, power, and to inspire fear. They're over you, you're under them. As Richard said, therefore you don't matter. The young black folks who we talk with expect to be treated with the suspicion of being a criminal by police. That's how kids think that most police see them. Can't imagine anything different. That's the way it is. That's their normal. In contrast, we interviewed over 100 kids, high school kids at the lab school. That's where one of my daughters attends. Elite school, predominantly white school, affiliated with the University of Chicago. Again, situated 4.5 blocks from the school that you heard each of those kids speaking. And I wasn't cherry picking those. What you heard from kids represented more than hundreds of interviews that we did. In contrast, not a single kid at lab in this more than 100 person audience, same age, actually other than my daughter, that's another story, but reported ever having been stopped or searched by police. Lesson number two we learned from the kids was the primacy of accountability. That's something also Nahal talked about. And as you heard too, and this was really a unifying theme articulated in one form or another by virtually every kid who we spoke with, police have all the power. And this knowledge of that unchecked power informs every encounter between kids and police. Every young black man, every girl, every young woman knows that this quote-unquote routine, and there's nothing routine about it, but these routine stop has the potential to escalate into something far worse. False arrests, years in prison, brutality, even death. Virtually every young black man and woman on the South Side of Chicago has a friend or a family member who has been beat, arrested, tased, or shot at the hands of police. That's also a part of our kids' everyday reality. And this unchecked power, it not only informs, but it eclipses the positive stuff. We heard about courteous, even friendly encounters that didn't change kids' basic perceptions. Kids share with us encouraging stories about good officers, greet them, treat them with respect, show an interest in their well-being. But at the same time that Officer Friendly is smiling and greets greets a student. Kids see officer not so friendly right across the street, shaking down and harassing the friends and neighbors right across the street. And the kids see those officers come back again, again, again. Nothing ever happens to them. When kids see officers abuse their friends and neighbors without any fear of punishment, that says a lot more to them about the department than that neighborhood officer that greets them with a smile. And indeed, it makes that smile just feel like a lie. What did Hasante say? That's the young man with the dreads. He's like, every encounter, there's no such thing as good encounters with police. Third, and I gotta thank my colleague Nahal and NYPD for this as well. Our kids' experiences associated with stop and frisk utterly undermine the possibility of building trust. Most courteous stops in the world don't change the basic, the unmistakable message that kids receive when stopped by police, and that's the message that we think you look like a criminal. And that's the honest. And if we can be honest with one another, we can be honest with ourselves. It's not just the honest message, it's the intended message. Because we're not even allowed to stop you unless we have a reasonable belief that you've committed a crime. And we're not allowed, and we can search you only if we have a reasonable belief that you're armed and dangerous. So no matter how respectful, think about it, no matter how respectful a police is when stopping and searching a child, telling that child that we think he or she looks like a dangerous criminal. Our health. Our work with kids also showed us just how deeply they're affected by this mess. And not just the stops, but the normalcy. I mean, the normalization of what you've been hearing today. Damage to their self-esteem, place in the world. As Jamari told us, they make you feel like less than a person. How the ever-present possibility of being stopped by police causes kids to curtail their own freedom at critical periods of their lives, their avoidance of even going outside. Kids that don't go outside, don't walk in groups, don't walk alone, all to be avoid fear of being stopped. How it cramps kids' horizons. One young man told me that he feels like prey when police cruise by in their car. And when they do, he tries to make himself look invisible. In addition, of course, many kids view this practice as fundamentally unfair, especially when it's in play with certain neighborhoods and with certain populations, not others. That's a particular practice reserved for Black, brown, and poor people in the neighborhoods in which we live. Final observation I'll share today before at least giving one message of I can't give you the plan today to fix stuff. Like to. Is the one though that's this observation is the one that really struck me the most and struck a lot of my students. And more than anything, what we were struck by was just how alienated kids were from law enforcement, their fundamental distrust of police. Young people don't feel safe to step up as witnesses, reluctant to even talk with the police, much less provide information about criminal activity. Many told us they wouldn't even call the police when someone near or dear to them was assaulted. Go to others, and sometimes, and usually not the folks might want them to go to protect them. We also look at a lot of data, and when we look at citywide data, we observed, just like the kids taught us, that the neighborhoods in Chicago that had the very most complaints of police abuse were also the very same neighborhoods that had the lowest clearance rates for solving violent crime. Just like kids taught us, police least successful solving violent crime in the areas where they had the least trust. How lack of police accountability makes us less safe, less healthy. All right, broadly, what to fundamentally do, I'm going to give just one example, you know, how to try to change this relationship. I mean, just as listening first, I mean, where this comes from, just as listening to the kids most affected by these practices informs our diagnosis, it also has to inform our treatment, our policies. And the experiences of Black kids and their families have led some to call for abolition. I mean, abolition, that the only path to change is abolishing the entire police apparatus. Woman told me recently, what use do I have for an institution that routinely kills people who look like me, makes it so I'm afraid to walk outside? Short of the more radical call for abolition, kids have taught us is that if we hope to build any positive relationship, much less trust between young black folk and police, conversation has to begin with honesty, some honesty, and it's got to end with basic accountability and respect. I mean, basically acknowledging our children's realities and their family's realities. Just being honest with people. Just like I would tell my daughter and her relationships with folks, be honest. I mean, not just be honest, don't trust people who lie to you. When something goes down, let them know what's going on. Keep people informed, don't lie, don't hide. If there's a video of something that went down, release it within 48 hours. That's what effective departments are doing. Acknowledging the realities of young black people also means doing things like passing a law that not just encourages, but actually requires every single police department to track information about what Nahal was talking about, where there's not data, what Todd started out talking about. It's beyond shameful. We don't even keep national data. We don't keep reliable data about when police shoot and kill people. You gotta speak some truth before we get to reconciliation. I was gonna talk to you about this beautiful data project that we created when law students and folks in the community, and I'll just mention it, first created this legal precedent in Illinois that police misconduct records belong to the people, and then to make that precedent, to make that principle real, created this community-owned database. This is just phenomenal, that has every single police misconduct complaint and what happened with it, the officers for the last 5 years, and actually has data that goes back to 2000. And if we're ultimately successful in this legal fight, we'll have information about every single complaint in Chicago from 1967 through the present, owned by the community, accessible to everybody, researchers, advocates, lawyers, investigators, people in prison, everybody. And that's a fundamental shift in power from the state to ordinary people. To close, just mention this. I guess two things, and I'll be quick. Even with stuff like this database and with honesty and accountability, change just isn't gonna happen by itself. I mean, opening police departments doesn't automatically eliminate the racism, sexism, and every other ism that exists within those departments. Doesn't end the code of silence, certainly doesn't end patterns of police abuse that have gone unchecked. But what it does is it creates the conditions to accomplish each of these things if we act. And so, final thing, I'll close on this. This is me as a younger lawyer, no here now. I was struck by an observation made by Doughboy, who was a character played by Ice Cube before he started making Barbershop and Are We There Yet and shit like that. In John Singleton's 1991 film, Boys in the Hood. And what Doughboy Ice Cube said then, he said, either they don't know or they don't show what's going on in the hood. Either we don't know or we don't care. Something changed after the release of that video of the police murder of that 17-year-old boy in Chicago. Curtain was lifted on reality. What Jonathan was talking about, but the reality, not just in Ferguson, but the slide that he showed at the end, the reality of police abuse, black communities, and the code of silence that protects us. So in Ice Cube's words, he say, we know. We also know what we need to do. It's pretty basic. Young black folks have led us to this moment, and they've challenged each of us to care. It's up to us to act on this moment.
So wow, I don't know what you want to do about time. Where's Dr. Quante? Do you want to take a few minutes? I know we're about 10 minutes over what the panel was supposed to be. Okay. In the back.
This question is for Mr. Smith. I've read the Ferguson report and a couple of other reports out of the DOJ with respect to law enforcement, patterns of practice, abuses with respect to constitutional and civil rights. And I guess my question is, where does the Department of Justice fall in terms of accountability? Most of these reports end up with kind of a findings and or a technical report that talks about things that should happen. But even New Orleans had a report written on it from 2011, and I would argue that not very much has changed with respect to how law enforcement officers are engaging in communities of color. And so my question is, with all due respect, what good does a Department of Justice report do if things aren't changing?
Right. So there are a couple of things, and that's I think a legitimate question. So the all due respect was not necessary. I mean, I have asked that question myself a lot. Spent a lot of time thinking about that. So there's a couple of things I want to say about that. One is the Department of Justice. When we went into a police department, we were authorized to investigate whether there's a pattern or practice of a violation of the Constitution or federal law. The very first thing to know about that is we were able to investigate whether there was a pattern or practice of a violation of law. And if you read the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court, there is a lot of things that police officers are authorized to do that are not illegal but are really bad. And so it's what I call the gap between what's lawful and what is right. And that's just as a foundational issue. The Department of Justice can't close that gap. And we got to remember, the Department of Justice is a law enforcement agency, and it's primarily, and so the Civil Rights Division's authority extends to a very specific set of issues about constitutionality. We acutely felt that gap working in the Civil Rights Division. I felt that gap. One of the reasons I'm not there is in part because of the inability to address that gap. That said, we developed, and New Orleans was the beginning and Ferguson was the end of that transformation of the way that we did our work, a set of strategies where we tried to use our work as a way to create the conditions for communities to use the work that we did and to allow us to take it as far as it could go, but to create the conditions for communities to take it to where it needed to be, because we couldn't do that. And so that's why it was important for us to have our, prior to 2010, investigations weren't publicly announced. They were government-to-government relationship. We developed this strategy where we would reach out to communities. As soon as we opened an investigation, we went into communities, we held community meetings, we met with all the communities that make up a jurisdiction, faith community, business community, people whose rights have been violated, rank-and-file police officers, police unions, because there's a difference between those two things, and tried to get that information. We tried to give voice through our reports, and I think they got better over time. I think Ferguson is much better than the early reports. I think Albuquerque is better than the early reports, because we learned. We tried to be a learning organization, like we tried to tell police departments they need to be learning organizations. And after we issued a report, we saw that as a moment of catharsis. Everybody now had a single set of facts to deal with. And we had these high-level recommendations, but before we negotiated agreement, we went back to all the stakeholders and says, what do you want to see in a reform agreement? And particularly focused on what do you want to see in terms of accountability, what role do you want to play in the development of policy, and what transparency do you want? We couldn't always get it in our agreements. They're imperfect, but they were negotiated deals. We had to get the city to agree in order to take it in front of a federal judge, or we'd have to sue. And each of the agreements in different ways, and they got better over time. I'm really proud of what we did in Seattle. I'm really proud of what we did in Portland. I'm really proud of what we did in Albuquerque. Have built into them a role for the community in the development of policy, but really significantly, the collection of a lot of data and the pushing of that data out in ways that people could use it. Much, much more work needs to be done to perfect that. We were learning about how to do it. But that's what, I think, there's a, you know, that's how we try to address it. But I think it's a, and I urge everybody, and people now call me frequently whose cities are being investigated and say, how do we deal with the Department of Justice? My answer is the organizing should continue completely unabated, yeah, because the Department of Justice has an important role and it can be very effective at some things, and particularly things like creating those systems of accountability as a matter of policy inside a department. But that transformative change that actually gives a democratic voice to the people most likely to be policed, Department of Justice can't get that, because that's not required by the Constitution. We can create the conditions to help people get that, but we actually couldn't create that. So people, DOJ should be a milestone in the organizing effort, but it's neither the beginning nor the end. It's just one more tool that people should use, but the real power has got to come from people insisting that these institutions are responsive to the democracy. They're not this opaque, authoritarian, paramilitary organization that they are. They're amongst our most opaque public institutions right now. Did you want to?
I mean, we work with folks across the country, that many activist groups and some lawyers that come together formally or informally, and they sue their police departments for abusing and violating their rights and killing them. And we always counsel on lobbying the DOJ to come in as one tool. And it's a limited tool, but a very powerful one. And with it brings a lot of attention, a lot of resources, and at times ways that you can wiggle around and get called for formal embodiments of bodies where affected communities can sit on those bodies and affect policy decisions. But the problem is that only can be leveraged around perfect issues, right? The perfect issues at which the DOJ can prove something fishy is down here and it's unlawful. And sometimes those perfect issues don't line up with all of the issues that are affecting communities. But when we're real about that, we recognize it, we use it effectively, then it's just another tool for us. But it still means we needed to organize before and after you guys come in. We need to continue to organize afterwards, and then we need to use those bodies so that they're the most affected bodies possible, so that they're not tokenistic. Oh, you sat in a meeting and then like you said something about a policy, but that the policy reflects and changes the reality under which you've been living.
I have a question, and it's primarily to Craig, but I think others might be able to address it as well. So, you know, one, this is, I'm kind of like moved by your commentary, all of you, in terms of the way in which we've been saying again and again, we need to look at the policies, practices, and representations, right? That's what structures these inequities. So as a newcomer to Chicago, I'm struck by the reparations, the ordinance, right? So the city of Chicago, well, activists in Chicago have been working and successfully received reparations for police torture that's been happening, right? And well, it happened in the past, but they're receiving the reparations currently for the, I think it's like 110 torture survivors, maybe more, what have you. So one, there's the acknowledgement, I think in terms of just the acknowledgement that was a fight that's won. Two is the physical manifestation of that in terms of creating a center on the south side of Chicago, right? So I've been in conversation with folks in terms of, as a planner, how can I contribute to like site location, and what does this mean in terms of a monument? Not just a monument, but it's a community center that we're trying to find a place for. I'm just curious, Craig, given that you know Chicago, I'm sure you know far more about this than I, like, how do you situate that as both a win and then the potential in terms of a center, you know, as they're trying to conceptualize it, right? So the city, part of the win was a bit of money that comes with both to the survivors, but then the money for this, a little bit of money for center, and then, you know, you'll build the organization from there. I'm just curious your view of that.
Yeah. That resulted from years and years of work, of organizing work, doing the kind of also human rights work that Nahal, Dr. Jones talked about, even going to and powerfully going to Geneva, and led by groups of young folks who took, and then, so here's a nice way, used data that I crunched, but then it was the young folks who then brought that stuff to Geneva and came back with, you know, this Roach et al. Report, but powerful, scathing report that Dr. Jones also spoke of. So situating though the in terms of those remedies, because I think that I think the most meaningful aspects to me, and because the money and the reparations aren't close to enough and aren't close to sufficient. But two of the things that I thought matter a lot were the was one which you talked about in terms of the monument, and also that this is going to be a part. So as we talk about not forgetting history, it's now a part. It's going to be a standard part of our Chicago Public Schools curriculum teaching this. But the thing that bugs me, and so that's the positive side, and this was a tremendous step forward, is acknowledgement, and something that you know still political leaders had been loath to do. But the message that came along with it when this happened and when this ordinance was passed and the mayor's message at this point was, now we can move on. And this is, but the thing is, let's close the chapter on this. That was history. That was then, this is now, when had failed to address any of the underlying conditions that allowed more than 100, in that case, mostly black men, to be tortured. And the word torture, I don't use lightly, tortured. And a number of whom remain in prison today as a result of that torture. So I'm even, I think, more hopeful when I just alluded to, this awakening. And I think an awakening that's again been led by the creative energies of young folks using video, using social media, but just, doing it, really doing it. And that has made the reality that I was talking about and that the kids really were talking about impossible to deny. I mean, so I was talking with Jonathan yesterday over dinner, just, it wasn't just so the release of this video here in Chicago, Laquan McDonald, mm-hmm. this, everyone could look, that's, let's call a duck a duck. It's a murder, it was an execution. They shot that boy like a dog. He shot that boy like he was a dog in the street. But what was much more deeply revealed was systems of impunity, of machinery, of denial, a code of silence. What was normal and striking to the most casual observer as normal was, and that shooting unfortunately isn't all that extraordinary, at least in Chicago, because we've had for 30 years one police shooting a week on average. For 30 years straight, 75% of the people shot black. No surprises, that hasn't changed year by year. What was the most extraordinary was what was revealed was just how normal that cover was. So suddenly, moments after this murder, moments, even when officers were doing things that were mostly right before until oh boy comes up on the scene. Moments after that, the life of a 17-year-old kid mattered a lot less than covering for a fellow officer. And that was not just, we're talking about line officers, but you saw a machinery that went from top to bottom. Official narrative, people talk about code of silence, which is a misnomer because it's really about lying. And official narrative was self-defense, shot in the back, single shot. And this was repeated all the way up through the top of the food structure, all the while having this video and hiding the truth. So I think that's what's been revealed. And I think in response to when you're looking back and we're talking about the history, is what was more historic to me was then forcing our leaders to have to admit as a matter of present day reality that no, can't just deny this happened. No, we can't just talk about one bad apple, but the reality of real and systemic racism, present day code of silence, that's what brings about change.
So I'm reluctant to stop this conversation because it's so powerful and so interesting, but I know that we've got another group that was supposed to start about 20 minutes ago. So I would like to ask you to join me in thanking this panel for a very powerful presentation. Thank you.